company are buying Connecticut Lock Over from London. 120 people, tram lines, steel pans, huge wind and brass section, dancers as well. And they're joined by 30 guest musicians from Scotland's leading street band organisation, which is called All Youth Music Act.
Music, I think, of the whole thing so far.
And those silk flags in the background, 200 young people carrying those silk flags, they've been designed by school children across the United Kingdom and the Commonwealth. It's been led by artist Shona Watt and created with a project by the Thames Festival Trust. And it's all about encouraging young people to learn more about the natural environment. But they have their hopes on those silk flags. They also have a representation of someone they admire. So some of them have gone for really famous people like Sir David Attenborough or Joe Wins. But one school picked Charlie, their dinner lady, and another school at the Globe Academy in Southwark, they picked their security guard, Michael.
People who've made a real difference to their lives, who they look up to, and that's what so much of this is about. And also, yeah, this attention on the environment and climate change, you can see that reflected in the imagery of these beautiful flags.
Baroness Doreen Lawrence is one of the heroes depicted on a flag. She's here today in the Royal Box. Now, the Queen's favourites. And this is a very funny section. The Coventry-based Imagineer have been in charge of this. And that is Coventry, obviously, the very much name of Lady Godiva. So 20 foot high Lady Godiva, wearing white, reflecting purity and innocence, leading their section of the parade. She's a symbol of social justice.
So heavy, it can't stay up.
She's operated by six puppeteers.
Claire, you said about the corgis, is this like, what
the yes. And also, you see the Queen's racing colours there in the background. They are a bicycle representation of some of the Queen's favourite horses. So, from her beloved pony Peggy and various horses like Betsy and Burmese, who she used to ride at Trooping the Coloured Doublet to the Princess Royal when she was going to San Marino to win the European Open Championship. And Estimate as well, they won the Gold Cup.
Oh,
trained by Sir Michael Stout, who yesterday won the Derby at Desert Crown, so the Queen would have been delighted. But down there in amongst it is AJ boogieing away with the corgis.
I certainly am, I'm living my best life! I tell you what, so far, there's a pageant, we have seen everything from giant dragons to people dressed as lions. You name it, the animals are out here in full force. But now it's the turn of the Queen's favourite, a pack of corgis. And here to tell me all about them is Sarah from theatre company Highly Sprung Sarah. Are the corgis behaving themselves?
They have been so naughty. They've been going everywhere. They've been causing absolute chaos. Chaos.
And I absolutely love it. How are you enjoying the atmosphere?
It's freaking
incredible. Spoiler. The people are amazing.
They're absolutely spoiler.
Incredible, I tell you what, I want one. Can I take one on? I
Goodness, I've currently has three dogs. She's got Sandy and Mick, who are corgis, and she's got Candy, who's a dorgie, so cross between a dachshund and a corgi. And corgis, Pepper Corgis actually in particular, renowned as being quite willful.
If you just switched on, you've missed my expert Martin Lewis on a bus, Truly being pushed along in a car, and now some toy corgis on wheels.
Surreal, I think, would be one of the adjectives used today. Along with magnificent and joyful and exuberant and just glorious. Princess, we're all saying, what's that art? She's looking for art. She's looking for the names of various horses. That's why she's probably looking for Doublet. He's a little bit further over, too far over to see, because obviously that's the horse she rode. Now the swans and the cygnets, there's this annual ceremony of swan upping, a census of the swan population on the River Thames, and young cygnets have their health checked by school children. And the swan very much closely associated with the Queen in particular.
Of course, in the royal part. And a royal wave from Prince George, my goodness, those children have really had a chance to finesse the royal wave this weekend. What an absolute treat for the Cambridge children as well.
It's quite cheeky, this piece, I like it. It's, as the title suggests, it's a nod to Her Majesty's absolute favourite things.
Now these large bow costumes that say Blue Bottle, representing the Royal Yacht Blue Bottle. And it was a wedding present gifted to the Queen and Duke of Edinburgh. And the elite dance academy performers around them in ocean costumes, they're forming a scene around the blue box. And it comes from Bristol-based Cirque Bijou, put together by their artistic director Julian Bracey and his team. And it's focused on the creativity and the potential, oh my word, of young people and the power of unity in communities. This is where it gets quite extreme. So I slightly started on my breath.
That's very, very small.
The balloon is just incredible, isn't it? The size of it.
I feel there may be more stunts there if you want to look high. From moving vehicles.
Yeah. That's bike trials champion Danny Butler. And he's heading out a team of four stunt riders.
I'm pleased about that. If you're going to rehearse any section,
better do this one.
So we've got this large mobile stage and two lollipop aerialists right there, a tower, trampolines as well for backflip there. Now, if we look towards Buckingham Palace, we will see that the Royal Standard has been raised, and that means Her Majesty the Queen is here.
Not sure whether Her Majesty would make it today. I've been waiting to hear at work from Buckingham Palace. What was the flag we all wanted to see today?
You'll also see, moving around the track, a group of wheelchair athletes.
Wheelchair basketball, a really big sport, but also wheelchair rugby, and this autumn sees the Rugby League World Cup, which is the men's, women's and wheelchair competitions, the first time all being staged on the same timeline, building up to finals.
It's really quite extraordinary.
So known as the Dream Olympics. It's the UK Pro Champion, World Power Pro Champion in 2019.
It is
a huge thank you to the Queen, but also that thank you paid by people to whom I think we owe huge thanks, key workers who have played an essential role during the pandemic. And the Tower Queen there, Yuande Kanike, a volunteer. And there are so many people within this section who have stepped up and looked after other people, put other people before themselves, and really are the heart of a wonderful community. Young people as well who are taking on the challenges of protecting the planet, and 14 silk flags carried by 28 key workers.
The key workers leading the performance. And what we have here is young people, young performers from Thurrock, Milton Keynes and London carrying those silk scarves.
Her Majesty the Queen has made such a point of thanking these key workers over the past 2 years. We've seen her, whether that's in video messages, Zoom calls, and of course in her birthday honours list as well. So many of these key workers have been rightly awarded and thanked for the incredible work they've done.
I'm so glad that, you know, lots lot of uncontrollable elements to this parade, but I am so glad that although it's grey overhead and a little bit overcast, it hasn't rained, because the silk of these flags and the beauty of the pageant, and also just the general mood and for the spectators as well, it is so much easier when it's not pouring.
Claire, we were at the Derby, weren't we? And before the Royal arrival and before the races, it was bucketing it down. It was meant to rain last night. It didn't. Nothing is going to rain on Her Majesty's parade.
I have been checking the weather every single day for about 2 weeks, but it's held off.
So all the flags and the silks in this thank you dance made from Murshidabad silk, a hand-woven silk that Connecticut has been using since 2017. It comes from West Bengal. And what beautiful, glorious colours. And what a lovely message to finish with. And I know the hope of the co-chairs was to convey the remarkable story of social and political development and economic progress that have transformed the world during Her Majesty's 70 years as head of the Commonwealth and as our Queen. And I think that has been displayed, but also just the joy, the energy, the positivity, the carnival atmosphere, the sounds, the sights. And you can see how much the youngsters in the Royal Box have enjoyed it. And it is certainly not over yet. We have Ed Sheeran still to perform. And as we know, the Queen is here. She is at Buckingham Palace. The balcony appearance will be very, very special indeed.
But a fitting final section of the pageant as we say thank you to Her Majesty the Queen for 70 years of public service.
Wonder if the crowds at the public stand have gone up. Took them a while before they realised she was on the balcony of the Queen.
Well, the way they are about to rush down the mall and the barriers being put across, I suspect word has got out. So as I say, an awful lot still to come from the pageant, the final piece of the puzzle, the final part of this 4-day celebration of our remarkable Queen. The Prince of Wales and Prince George really, really enjoying it. And all of the younger members of the royal family, I think this has been, it's been fabulous for them, because they wouldn't know anything about the 60s and 70s, why would they? And the characters on the buses now taking another turn around the Queen Victoria Memorial, they've got another chance to see them and be explained to, you know, by their parents and grandparents and who everybody is and what they represent
in the 80s.
Well, that was, I think that's why the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge wanted to take Prince George and Princess Charlotte and to Cardiff yesterday. This is what Mummy and Daddy do when we go off to work, and it's important they understand, particularly for Prince George, because this is one day what he's going to do.
So as I say, Ed Sheeran still to come, and an awful lot more before the Platinum Jubilee celebrations finally come to a close. But Kirsty, for now, it is back to you.
Well, thanks so much to Claire Balding and indeed, of course, to all of her commentary team for what has been an extraordinary pageant. 220 volunteers making it happen. We saw 200 horses at the beginning. There we are, the buses, the celebrities still waving. 7,800 of a performing cast and an estimated 1 billion people watching this spectacle all around the world. And as we mentioned for the first time this afternoon, we are hoping to see Her Majesty. We have seen the royal standard raised over Buckingham Palace just a few minutes ago, as Claire mentioned, and we're hoping that along with Her Majesty will be
appearing
together on the balcony, the Prince of Wales,
she's there.
Duke of Cambridge, and the young Prince George. That is a sight possibly to come, but for now we're seeing the closing moments of the pageant. So what a pageant it was. Spectacular. Well, part of the fun of any royal occasion is the theatre, not just of the pageant, but of all the wonderful fashion that's on display. Here with me now to discuss the importance of outfits for the Queen throughout the decades and what we've seen over the various royal sporting their outfits over the past few days are designers Amanda Wakely and Oswald Boateng. Welcome to both of you, looking sharp, looking wonderful. let's talk about clothes, because of course we've seen that spectacle, but since Thursday we've also seen people turn out in more than their Sunday best. And I wanted to talk about the Queen and clothes, because I think, Amanda Wakely, I get the feeling that there's a bit of a myth that surrounds the Queen and clothing, which is she's not really interested. I don't believe it for a second. What do you make of her fashion? What do you make of Her Majesty?
I think she's passionately interested, and I think she's diplomatic in her choices and quite symbolic in her choices. And I love the fact that fairly early on, she apparently with Turier decided that because she's sort of slightly diminutive in stature, that actually to stand out in the crowd, and let's face it, people from far and wide come to see her, and they want to see her, that she was going to wear these lovely strong colours and head to toe. So the hat matching the pose with the dress.
Interesting in this platinum jubilee year that we're all at it now, aren't we? I mean, look at you.
Well,
but you know, she was in that respect, the sort of joy that she took in colour was sort of well ahead of us.
You know, I love her.
And I like the word joy, because it is joyous, yeah, yeah. You know, to see colour being worn and to see her really stand out in the crowd.
Also, of course, we're looking there at some of the colours that the Queen has worn over the years. Brave decision.
Yeah, but very good use of colour, right? I mean, there's orange, there's greens, there's reds, pinks, blues. That's very nice.
And do you agree with Amanda and me that that is somebody who's taking a degree of joy in
this? Well, it obviously takes confidence to wear that colour, right? So she clearly knows that she can wear it and she holds it with the right stature. And then also it's tailoring as well, which helps.
Green.
Let's look back a little bit. I mean, probably, is it the most famous thing that the Queen wore to begin with? Certainly, it received the most attention in her early days was the Norman Hartmann gown that she wore to marry Prince Philip in. Take us through a little bit of the detail of that incredible wedding dress.
Well, as you said, designed by Sir Norman Hartmann. She apparently was very involved in it. He created 8 final sketches, and she took a bit of one and another, and the embroidery was very symbolic of
the nations of the Commonwealth.
The nations of the Commonwealth, yes. A beautiful embellishment and embroidery, and yet the charming story of the government granting her more of her rations, her clothing rations, to create this beautiful gown.
Yes, and I think throughout the years, if we look beyond that, I want to ask you about hats. Now, hats are a tricky thing, and the Queen, of course, she has to wear them because it's the correct thing to do, but a difficult thing to wear at all?
Yes and no, actually, because I mean, she's, again, it's all about confidence, and she exudes that. I mean, you can look at the mount, the scarves and the hats over there. No, look, but what I like is that she's experimental with her hats, but more importantly, she's making sure that they fit with the look in the right way. I mean, at the end of the day, it's all about that.
Well, let's take a look at some of the fashion that we've seen then over the last 4 days. I would think that probably it was the service of Thanksgiving on Friday morning where we really saw the big guns come out in terms of the beauty of the outfits that were worn. I'm thinking immediately of the Duchess of Cambridge in that, I'm going to call it a Malfi lemon yellow, because it just brought sunshine into the St. Paul's, didn't it?
It was the most immaculately cut coat dress by Amelia Wixon, and then that beautiful Philip Tracy hat, which just, and her hair was coiffed so perfectly. I thought she was immaculate.
The Countess of Wessex as well was something that I felt had a hint of platinum. It was a lovely sort of dusty, soft, mauvey pink, but it also shimmered as she moved, and it seemed a very clever choice with that beautiful flutter sleeve.
Yes, beautiful, beautiful.
We also saw the Duchess of Sussex was wearing, now that was
Dior haute couture.
Right, so very fancy. Now, was it grey, was it white, was it lilac?
I wasn't there in person. Apparently it had a shade of lilac about it, but quite hard to read in the photographs.
Yes, indeed. Well, thank you very much for the fashion chat. That's a little passion of mine. I'm very interested in what everybody wears, so thank you for indulging me and for indulging people at home. Thanks for joining us, and happy Jubilee weekend.
And to you.
The area in front of the palace is filled with people eagerly awaiting the balcony doors to open and for their chance to see the Queen, Her Majesty, this afternoon. Just before we see her, Ed Sheeran will be serenading the crowd with a classic. Anita is with Mr. Sheeran now.
I am with one of the world's biggest music stars, Ed Sheeran. First of all, congratulations. Baby number 2 is 2 weeks old.
Yeah, thank you so much.
So you've been let off love daddy duties?
Yeah, I'm going back after this, actually, yeah.
What will you do? Give her a bath?
I think we're going to have a curry.
Now, Ed, you have played some of the biggest venues in the world to hundreds of thousands of people. How does that compare?
For me, this is like it's kind of like a full circle nostalgia moment, because this is the event that I picked up guitar at 20 years ago, seeing Eric Clapton play on stage, and then got to play it 10 years ago for the Diamond Jubilee, and then yeah, it's like really, really nice to be back. It's just a great atmosphere here.
And what is that feeling like, you know, the little you who saw Eric Clapton play, and here you are again to play this historic event?
I find it really surreal. I really do find it surreal. I've still got the Party at the Palace DVD at my house, and I do, it is, these events make you sort of like think yourself.
And what's the atmosphere like for everyone at home?
It's really nice. Everyone seems to be in a very, very good mood, and touch wood, weather's all right.
Yeah, there is a real sense of joy and huge emotion as well. Everyone's feeling very patriotic.
Well, it's very rare you kind of get days like this to feel patriotic. I think the last time was the Euros final, was you actually felt it in the city. But yeah, it's really, really nice.
Are you ready? Ready to get up there and do your thing?
Yeah, feel great.
Have a great one, Ed. Thank you so much. Enjoy.
Thanks so much. Well, whilst we wait for the finale, AJ is joined by Olympic gold medalist Kadina Cox and Sir Chris Hoy.
Hello! Fresh from the glory here at the pageant, I am joined by Olympic heroes Kadina Cox and Sir Chris Hoy. How are you? You have just led a peloton of 300 cyclists down the mile towards Buckingham Palace. How did that feel?
It was incredible. It brought back memories of 2012. Seeing everybody else celebrating and enjoying themselves, it's just been a wonderful day, it really has. It's an honour.
Absolutely, and what was the atmosphere like that?
Do you know what, it was an absolutely amazing atmosphere, you know, everyone cheering, like, for me, I just came back from a Paralympics where there was no fans, so that for me was like a fan moment, it just felt so real.
And speaking of fan moments, there have been so many famous faces here. Come on, who have you been starstruck by?
Well, I had a selfie with Timmy Mallett, that was amazing. He's riding at the moment, he's doing a ride around the whole circumference of the UK. So he's a top man, never met before, always watched him on telly as a kid, so yeah, that was pretty cool.
That's a special moment. What about you, Kadina?
Do you know what, it was just the glam of Nicole Scherzinger, and they're like, come on, girl. I know Ed Sheeran's lurking around, hi Emma, where you are.
It's amazing that we have all come together, people near and far, celebrities, everyone has come out to celebrate.
Oh my god.
Fingers, legs and eyes crossed. Well, we watched
the flag never lies when she's in.
In today's pageant, let's just remind ourselves
the education of these people. I don't know anything.
Pathetic.
It's just idiotic.
Welcome to our journey through the decades, and believe me, I've travelled the world.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock.
In the 1950s, the year of rock and roll, for Her Majesty the Queen, it was the decade that began the long reign. And the coronation was a spectacle, and it was watched live around the world. In 1957, we saw the Queen hold her first television broadcast on Christmas Day. Notably, it was the first time we saw our monarch speaking from her own home.
Britain in the 60s became the focus of the fashion and music world. Britain's streets were swinging and the nation was singing, and the Queen handed Bobby Moore the World Cup after England beat West Germany. Advancements in technology saw Concorde take its first flight, and Her Majesty made it into space. The Queen recorded a very special message and was taken on a disc by Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin on their mission to the moon.
Just 70s, what a great decade!
Here's what has become a home of all rebellious, with a hot lounge in combats like the sex.
Charles put the tracks like true gone. And the Queen, the 18th of August, celebrated the marriage between Prince Charles and Lady Diana Spencer. She also saw new additions to her family with the birth of her grandchildren, Sarah Phillips and Prince William.
Welcome to the 90s. The 90s were in your face. While we could dominate in the charts worldwide, the original Spice Girl and Majesty had a tough, tough decade. It saw a fire at her beloved Windsor Castle. And she supported her whole family through one of the darkest times in the royal family. But remained, as always, a pillar of strength.
The noughties saw a huge technological boom. The internet changed the world forever, and the way we watch television would never be the same again, as we saw the birth of reality shows such as Pop Idol, Big Brother, and The Apprentice, if I. It was a decade of celebration for Her Majesty the Queen, who celebrated the marriage of Charles and Camilla, as well as reaching a huge milestone herself, her Golden Jubilee, which marked 50 years on the throne.
Welcome to the 2010s. The London Olympics saw Team GB's athletes bring home the gold, and the world was stunned when we thought Her Majesty had jumped out of a helicopter alongside James Bond. Social media transformed the way we communicate with each other, and not to be left behind, the Queen sent her first tweet in 2014. For the last 70 years, Her Majesty has been a symbol of strength and stability and has led the nation through one of the most remarkable chapters of social history in British life.
Wonderful picture as well. I'm rejoined by Robert Hartman, also by the actress Jenny Agutter, and Lulu has made it over from the commentary box. And I just want to talk to the three of you about what we've just seen. Some of it bizarre, some of it enlightening, and some of it truly visually remarkable. What did you make of it?
Oh, yeah.
How do you capture 70 years